Can you see my presentation and my pointer? Or the,
yes.
The...
Well, I can.
Great, thanks. Okay, so thanks also from my side for this nice and lively discussion and putting together the program. I want to tell you a story of 3 points. Namely, first point is that we are using a unified approach to the nonlinear rheology of viscoelastic fluids. And this is a specific aspect. It's an approach that can be applied to various cases. And I want to bring two test cases. One is the anomalous motion of a particle feeling and force, so a microrheology study. And the second story then is on stress diffusion in colloidal glasses. So that this type of looking with correlation function, transient correlation function, identifies a diffusive process for stresses relaxing in a colloidal glass. And before I come to the specific topics and a little bit more why this might be of interest to experiments and studies of viscoelastic liquids, let me quickly say something on this unified approach of the theory. And these are the two cases that that I already mentioned, the macroscopic rheology, microrheology, where, for example, you're applying shear rate, always looking at dense suspensions in the following. Hard colloidal particles will be what I'm thinking of. And rheology then is if the shear rate compares to the inverse relaxation time, then you get big effects, the Press-Pickley number then becomes large. In the microrheology experiment, I'm considering the simple setup of applying a fixed force on an individual particle in this dense dispersion. And then question of interest is, say, the local friction that this particle feels when it moves with velocity v in direction of the force. And what to me from a theory side is the nice aspect that those two cases are covered by the so-called Smoluchowski equation, Fokker-Planck type of equation for the many body probability distribution function, which is also the topic in many other theories, John Brady's theory, for example, to calculate this psi distribution function of the particle positions. And the Smoluchowski operator, the time evolution operator omega, in that case, the standard equilibrium aspects here are the diffusive bit. Hydrodynamic interactions are neglected because we are looking at high densities where particle interaction matter. And the particle interaction comes via forces acting on particle I from the other particles. This familiar equilibrium Smoluchowski operator in the case of microscopic flow with a shear rate tensor kappa is just linearly changed in this fashion given here with kappa, the shear rate tensor or the velocity gradient tensor given in red here. So you have a linear change in the time evolution operator. And the same holds in the microrheology case. You have, again, your diffusion of the particles I of the cells, tracer particle with index S. And then this individual particle is feeling in force Fx, the external force. So you have a simple theoretical setup where the time evolution is changed in a linear fashion. But still, if you then calculate, for example, in the macrorheological context, the stress as a function of time, you end up with a non-linear result, generalized Green-Kubo relation, where the time evolution of the stress sigma kappa of t is the velocity gradient tensor, and the time evolution with the Smoluchowski operator that depends on the flow through the history of the system enters this time evolution, enters the problem here in this nonlinear Green-Cooper relation. And things are identical in principle in the microrheological context where you are interested in the friction coefficient describing the velocity at long times. Then again, this friction coefficient theta is given by relation generalized Green Kubo-like relation. Here you would call it a force velocity correlation, where the quantity known from linear response, the forces acting on the particle Fs, is averaged. The nice and handy aspect of the approach is that the averages are always close to equilibrium. So you can do equilibrium averaging here, but the nonlinearity of the driving enters via the time evolution here in this Smoluchowski operator with indices irreducible for technical reasons. In both cases, so you see averaging done by equilibrium averages, but the time evolution through the buildup of the stationary state enters. This is meant by this acronym ITT, integration through transients. And the physics in the problem enters then after Mohr coupling approximations, done in the same spirit all the time, going back to Goetz's work on the Mohr coupling theory. Physics of the different situations enters via these transient density correlation functions, which describe how under the external forcing, driving, shearing, whatever the structure, so rho of Q is the Fourier transformed density fluctuation, how the structure changes under the external driving. Again, external driving enters via the time evolution, the Smoluchowski operator mentioned already. And this scheme, this unified scheme for describing nonlinear rheological mechanical properties of viscoelastic fluids, this is what I want to show you in two test cases, microrheology and macrorheology. And in the one case, I think this transient density correlated becomes very transparent. And in the other case, there are some interesting rheological consequences that I would like. Let me go to this active microrheology case at first, because there the transient density correlator takes a good interpretation. And this is in a way the modern question of friction of a particle immersed in a fluid, going of course back to Stokes with his friction of a particle moving with velocity v in a solvent with viscosity eta. And this simple problem, what the force of a particle moving in a fluid is, becomes of course, as you well know, becomes of course complicated already when the velocity becomes larger than you have a crossover here to Newtonian behavior where the friction goes with velocity squared. But we are actually interested in the totally opposite limit, namely where the velocities become very, very small of the force particle because the surrounding liquid becomes very dense and you are actually close to moving this particle through a amorphous solid. And that's now specific what I'm interested in. Want to show you some new experimental data from Fribourg also. So you have a individual particle here in red, force Fx is acting on it, and the surrounding particles actually are of the same size. D is the diameter of these particles, let's take them as hard colloidal particles. And this example is so nice because this transient density correlator that I introduced in the general framework here takes an easy interpretation, namely it's the self part of the Van Hove function. So it's the probability distribution function for finding the particle, the force particle at position r at time t, assuming or conditioning on that it was at the origin at time t equals zero when you started applying the force. So this density correlator that enters the theory phi sq of t is the Fourier transform of this probability distribution function and thus has a very intuitive interpretation, at least when Fourier transformed back into real space. The equation of motion of this density correlator here is just given for reference and for people interested because we use this technique of parallel relaxation channels that Fano, Schilling and others developed for in different contexts. And now if you have this quantity, you can, for example, look at the probability of finding the particle at a distance z in direction of the force or x perpendicular to this, of course, this cylinder symmetry. And you can ask this for the particle being stuck in a glass so that without force, the particle cannot move. And this caging in the mean squared displacement that George just pointed out can be seen in the probability distribution function here. These are equal probability lines here. The particle is localized at the origin and cannot move. And if you now apply the force, stronger and stronger forces, you see that the particle gets shifted in direction of the force, but there are also some probability leaking out in front of it, making larger and larger steps. The probability distribution here gets anomalous in that sense that it develops a exponential tail in the direction of the force that's shown here. So this is this probability in direction of the force as function of z in units of the diameter. So the particle is either slightly localized and moving somewhat in direction of the force, but then also there is this exponential tail and the correlation length here becomes larger and larger upon increasing the force with a critical force where the particle then can be pulled out of its local cages and can start moving through the amorphous solid. And we are lucky to have simulations from Antonio Portas here also in that context, which show similar things seen here for different density forces. So there is a phase diagram here, and let me only focus on the glassy regime. So packing fraction above phi critical, the glass transition density. In red here, small force regime where the particle stays localized. And if the force exceeds a critical threshold, the blue line here, the particle gets delocalized. And this is where I'm interested in following. This is where I want to show you experiments from Frank Scheffold's group in Fribourg on how the particles move when they get delocalized here in this green regime. There's critical dynamics in there that we analyzed in time space here. As also seen by Antonio, but let me jump to experiments. I hope you can see the video of the experiment by performed by Nesrin Senbil in Fribourg. If the force is rather small, this particle of diameter roughly 2 micrometers is not moving much. It's within a glassy system, emulsion droplets, therefore for you almost do not see the glassy dispersion around it. But now in the second video, the force is larger and you see that the particle is moving in the direction of the force and wiggling also perpendicular. And this motion here is really quite anomalous. That is the selection of the trajectories measured for identical experiments. The displacement in force direction here as function of time. And you see that some of the particles move very quickly, while other trajectories here remain localized for a very long time. So if you then record the histogram, the PDF for the individual experiments, you see in the experiment a rather broad distribution of particles that remain stuck and particles that move rather far. And if you calculate the theory, then you find a very broad distribution indeed. Asymptotically, even you find a bimodal distribution of one population remaining rather localized, while another population can move through the glassy system in direction of the force and moves with time further and further out. So compared to the liquid mean square to the liquid Van Hove function, the distribution is by far broader. The two distributions, a liquid left and a glassy distribution on the right hand side, compared here. And if you look at the individual trajectories already, you see the far broader spread, the anomalous distributions in the glasses. And those anomalous distributions here that come from theory or experiment or are seen in theory in the experiment, then presumably lead to the super diffusive behavior and to other anomalies that have been seen for this microrheological experiment in computer simulations by Jürgen Rohrbach. This is where we haven't been able to work out the theory in detail yet, but we're working on it. So here, what I liked a lot is that this ITT approach that we are using in general leads to density correlation function that can be interpreted and be seen in experiments. In my second example, where this type of approach is being applied, well, here the experimentalists, Nesrin and the group of Frank Scheffold. In my second example, where this theoretical approach is being applied, we now look at forces transmitted through the liquid. So say you have again a particle or some forcing at the origin, this ellipsoid here, and in specific case we are looking at the forcing done by some shear deformation, like in the elastoplastic theories, Jean-Louis Barras and co-workers. And if you now apply such a forcing at the origin, the question is, what are the stress fields surrounding it? And in this figure here, which is from Andreas Zumosch in Konstanz, there are already these force coils, these angular dependencies plotted that one expects if one goes into a solid, which go by the name of Eshelby pattern, these long-range stress fields that one expects in elastic solids. And presumably here, this is what Andreas Sumbusch wanted to express, those stress fields should also apply in complex fluids and deform particles. This is why there are emulsion droplets here on this figure. And let me tell you where these stress fields come from and how they can be described. And as we are in a viscoelastic liquid, any discussion of stresses, of course, goes back to Maxwell with the relaxation of the shear modulus G of T, explaining the stress as a function of time T at a later time when deformation, or precisely a velocity gradient dvx by dy, was applied at an earlier time t prime. And Maxwell's model with this exponential relaxation time tau that then explains the viscosity was, of course, basic understanding of viscoelasticity. And it's, however, only the description of the macroscopic response, wave factor q equal to zero, and the question that we started out with and were interested in, what is the spatially dependent, the local generalization of this macroscopic Maxwell response? So what's the description of the stress at space point r and time t when the velocity gradient is applied at another space point r prime at an earlier time t prime? So this is the generalization of Maxwell's description to finite wave factors, can be done in linear response. So in the following, I'm only talking about linear response at the moment. And the approach that can be used, as I said, is this correlation function type of approach, also used for the microrheology. Here, specifically, the stress-stress correlation function is being analyzed in the concepts of isotropy and slow modes, as familiar from Plassey dynamics. I don't want to go into the details of theory here. Let me rather try to convey the message of the theory in some pictures and in some context of a simpler model that we call generalized Maxwell model, and that is based on Maxwell's original model that I recalled here again. So not in the integrated fashion that I described or mentioned before, but in the differential equation. So stresses are generated by velocity gradients and they decay with an intrinsic time scale tau. This is Maxwell's model. Here I'm, for simplicity, looking only at incompressible flow, divergence V equals zero. And if there are no forces, then at long times, this stress is divergence free. And this Maxwell model, if you want to look at local phenomena, needs to be generalized in one specific way, namely the first or most important aspect is the velocity field that generates stresses is not only the external velocity field or the solvent velocity field that you would then model with a shear rate, but it also contains the drift velocity, the motion of the colloidal particles. So the velocity here is a sum of solvent moving and the particles moving in the solvent. And the description of the motion of the particles in the solvent is given by a force balance. So the forces acting or generated by the stresses, divergence of the stress here, they are balanced by the friction force of the particles relative to the solvent. The friction coefficient theta naught enters there. And this model here then describes the local relaxation, and it's basically its consequences that I would like to point out as my last point. This equation here has some limits that can be understood and analyzed. In the fluid case, so short relaxation times, one goes back to equation by Brinkmann, as Thomas Franosch pointed out. And the physics, however, is slightly different. In the opposite limit of long relaxation times, the approach here recovers elasticity theory. So the solution then of the Green's function for applying sort of an elastoplastic deformation at the origin is identical to Eschelby's solution, as for example discussed by Picard and others from the elastoplastic community. So you have this fourfold stress pattern, stress maxima and minima are changing when going through the angles theta. And the approach basically achieves to interpolate in between the fluid Brinkmann case to the Eschelby case in the limit of those two timescales. If you have underdamped case, this also can be handled in a Newtonian case. So what's the status on this theory comparing to experiments or simulations? In the dilute fluid case, in the Langevin case, there are simulations by Antonio Puertas from Almeria, looking at the friction of an individual particle in such a Langevin system here, looking for Stokes' law. And this approach here explains that Stokes' law is not valid because there is a crossover from this vorticity diffusion as you would need for Stokes' law, as it's described in the Navier-Stokes equation, to Langevin friction at larger distances here. So this explains why in his measurements of friction coefficients, Antonio did not see the blue line Stokes coefficient when he looked at the friction coefficients as a function of the size of the tracer, AT, but found data that follow more the theory that I explained. There's another aspect where the theory connects to other people's work, namely this is the discussion from dynamic density function theory. The theory makes a statement on what is the particle current arising in such a fluid of Brownian particles. And the particle current that is one of the central quantity of dynamic density function theory. Dynamical density functionally in the simple fashion would say that particle current is given by the lower line here. The so-called power functional theory by Matthias Schmidt would say that there are such super adiabatic contributions, and their power functional theory and the approach that I described agree and have similar structure in the hydrodynamic limit. Okay, what's however then the most interesting aspect of the theory if you go into the colloidal glass state? There, to me personally, surprising finding was that stresses become not only anisotropic, this was known, but also they diffuse. Here there are spectra for different wave vectors of stresses in specific direction of wave vector space, namely parallel to the shearing plane. And you see by the motion of the peaks for different wave factors that the stress relaxation here is diffusive, and the diffusion coefficient is given by the elastic modulus mu divided by the friction coefficient. So there's interesting phenomena going on that should also appear in the spectra. These are spectra of a colloidal fluid measured by Miriam Siebenberger in the Banoff group. And if she goes into the colloidal glass, the theory that Mohr coupling theory that described those spectra quite well in the fluid state fails for the very small frequencies here in this regime. And if you now make a simple model and say that, she has a rheometer of, say, a gap of 10 millimeter. And if you then say that this is roughly correspondent to a wave factor, 2 pi divided by this rheometer gap, then with the parameters measured, hydrodynamic radius, diffusion coefficient, et cetera, one could see that those relaxation curves here could correspond to the diffusive process predicted by the field. But this is not yet tested indeed. Okay, so the summary of the second point is that the stresses are rather more interesting than at least I expected. They have long length scales already in fluid. They have this far field pattern by Eschelby. It has been seen in strain by Peter Schall in colloidal systems, but not yet in the stresses in colloidal systems. And the stress diffusion in the colloidal glass is one aspect that's also not yet seen. The second part of the work was done together with Annette Zibelius in Göttingen and Peter Keim and his co-workers in the experiment, and Sebastian Fritsch, Manuel Meyer, Florian Vogel made the experiments. So if I may summarize the three points that I tried to convey to you is that the correlation function description of rheology, nonlinear rheology is possible, and that there are interesting aspects that can be obtained from using the time dependence, transient time dependence, or the symmetry properties of these correlation functions. So with this, I thank you for your attention.
Oh, thank you very much, Matthias. There's also a lot of material, but very, very interesting. I think there is at least one question in our audience from Patrick Hill. Hey, Patrick, if you want to ask.
Hello. Yeah, thanks for the nice talk. I just wanted to make my applause to that. I didn't have a question, actually.
Jörg, question for
Jörg? Yeah, can I ask a question, please?
Yeah, please, Jörg.
Yeah, thank you very much, Matthias, for this very interesting talk. I would have a question concerning your first part where you showed the exponential tail in the Van Hove function. I think it was slide 15 in particular. Right, slide 15, please.
No, wait.
15, not 13. Four more.
I forgot that there are numbers. This is 15?
Oh, no. Then it's wrong. It was the Van Hove function where you had, you just showed it. There was one panel where you had this sort of a shoulder. You had a localized peak and a sort of a shoulder, and then later on an exponential decay. Yeah, something like that. Yeah, let's take this one. This reminds me a lot of continuous time random walks that would predict a very similar behavior, a localized peak, which would be the first one. And then the structure with the shoulder and the exponential tail is due to jumps. So the question would be, can the theory be put in a similar structure as a continuous time random walk, which also allows to calculate the Fraunhofer function? Have you ever thought about something like that?
We have thought about it. We have not been able to make it work. The great suggestion that you have, and it's really a very nice connection there. Not sure yet whether we have all that we need for the continuous time random walk analysis from the theory. Mm-hmm. So we need the waiting time distribution, mm-hmm. but then also the step size distribution.
Well, Matthias, my question was different. The continuous time random walk would allow you to cast the Fraunhofer function in a form that is similar to the integral differential equation that you get from MCT. And therefore, is it formally possible to compare your MCT, or let's say projection operator work, with this continuous time random walk framework, and then to identify the memory kernels? It was not, it was rather at that level.
This is in a way what we've done. We did not do it precisely like you suggested, but we in a way did an analysis of the dynamics similar then to what you would ask in continuous time random walk model, dynamics, and that was not so successful as we hoped. For example, we do not find super diffusive motion from this, we find regular motion. So in a way, this has been done, but I think there is much more potential in there. Your question points to additional possibilities because we have this anomalous dynamics of the local peak. So this comparison that I showed with Antonio Prater's simulations here shows that there are anomalous power laws in the local PDF. And that should enter into the this time analysis. But this is work going on.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Let's please keep in contact and discuss this at some point.
Okay. Yeah, fine. Yeah.